Good evening, hockey fans!
Hi everyone and welcome to Clan Chat, where we chat to former players and remind them of the fun they had playing for Brayhead or Glasgow Clan. Anyway, I'll take you around to who's joining us this week. Top left-hand corner, the star of Burniston, Saddled, Still Game and friend of the Clan sponsors. Hello to all of you out there. Have you spotted any more Clan doppelgangers this week, Gerry, since you saw Vili Himalainen's brother?
That was amazing, wasn't it? Benny, you might have missed this, but I was watching the Scottish football at the weekend.
It was about to start. One of the guys that was chatting looked exactly like Vili Himalainen.
I think Barry McKenzie actually got in touch with me and said that it was he was thinking exactly the same thing at the same time. So it was pretty good. It must have been good. Yeah. No, I'm not. That's the only one. But it's now my hobby. I'm going to start looking out for Clan doppelgangers.
Good to have you on board again. Bottom left-hand corner, the voice of the Clan himself, Kevin McCoskrie, a man with silky smooth dulcet tones, now back following what sounded like the shortest house move ever. Was it four doors down you moved, Kevin?
Not quite, but it certainly wasn't very far. Moved in a wheelbarrow.
Saves money, doesn't it? Saves money.
Yeah. Excellent. But it's pretty stressful, though. Everybody says it's one of the most stressful things you can do. I mean, I feel as if I've aged about 10 years, so I must be looking about 30 or 40 this week, I'll tell you.
Not a day over 31.
And here we go, at the bottom of the screen, literally just arrived. We are recording, Matt, so watch your language. Far be it for me to accuse him of only joining us when his pals are here. It's the Clan captain himself, Matt Haywood. Good to see you again. How's things?
I couldn't leave Benny to get bullied by you lot, so I thought I'd jump on.
And there he is, a special guest. Underneath me on the screen, it's Ben Davies, number 5 for 2 years between 2014 and 2016. The word legend banded about a lot quite freely these days, but in GB terms, I think it certainly can be true, and not to be confused with the defender of Tottenham Hotspur, who goes by the same name. Ben Davies, how the devil are you, and how are things where you are?
Yeah, I'm good, thank you. I'm good. Just getting through lockdown or whatever version of lockdown we're in right now. So, yeah, just missing hockey in general. I'm sure everyone is, and yeah, excited to be on you.
Excellent. Now, first question, I'll hit you with one on the spot there. We'll get this one out early. Of all the teams you've played for, whether it's Cardiff, Basingstoke, the Clan, Swindon, Coventry, Guildford, Norfolk Admirals, Melbourne Mustangs, which one was your favourite to play for and why are you picking the Clan?
No, honestly, I think, well, Glasgow was obviously my first one out of Cardiff. Obviously, I had been to Basingstoke and Swindon briefly for both of those, but I think I'd probably see Glasgow as my first proper move away from Cardiff, and I just always felt at home at Glasgow. Obviously, I've still got lifelong friends from playing there, and obviously all you guys on the Zoom as well, and yeah, I do really look back with fond memories of Glasgow. My mum was actually doing a clear out last week or so. I was trying to find this thing to show you, Matt, and everyone else on here. But it was a cookbook we done. I think it must have been the first year. And I've been trying to turn the place upside down. I know it's around because I was reminiscing going through it. And it was all at our little flat. Like everyone was just posing with stupid stuff. Like I think someone was just posing with like a tub of peanut butter. Because we just had to like all take pictures and we didn't have enough ingredients for everyone. But yeah, just looking through the team.
And, was that Chris Frank's cookbook? Was it that the same cookbook? Yeah, yeah, right, okay.
It was honestly...
We all had a 2 minute slot at Benny's flat. So we all had the same picture in the same kitchen with like a can of beans and the next guy would have...
That was it. It was brilliant.
I think there was a couple of hundred of them still lying about the Clan office for quite a while. I don't think they were all shifted. I think it was very successful, but there was quite a few left. But
yeah, there's some just rushed together recipes in there as well.
Like cheese on toast.
Absolutely. What kind of recipes are we talking here? I'm not expecting a Nigella Lawson book by any stretch of the imagination, but what did you have in there?
Well, I think, honestly, one of mine was tuna omelette, I think. Which like doesn't
it's just an omelette with tuna.
Yeah, just an omelette, and I was struggling for an agree. I must have already done a chicken dish, so I thought, yeah, just throw a tuna omelette in.
Joe, can I ask you, Benny, and this to you as well, Woody, you know, when you're, if you're like young players and like you're leaving home for like in a first time, I mean, that can kind of happen. I mean, a lot of folk, you know, when the first time you move out of, you know, your parents' house, that's a big thing anyway. But if you're being a pro athlete and you suddenly find yourself having to feed yourself and stuff, that must be quite a big shock for some people. I bet some folk are better at it than others. How did you find it, Benny, that first time away from the home cooking? I mean, you look after your health anyway, don't you? You're always been quite a healthy eater. Yeah, but have you always been good at food?
I think only recently, maybe the last year or two, I've really tried to take a little bit more care and take a bit more pride into it, to be honest. I quite enjoy doing it now. But for the first few years, I was trying to stay healthy, but it would just be like somewhat boring. So like broccoli and then like a piece of meat and some other stuff. But I think now I'm trying to get into it a little bit more. But just adapt on where I'm going. I'm definitely no cook. That's
for sure. But, what about you, Woody?
Well, I was a bit younger when I moved away, not like Benny. Benny was a bit mature when he actually moved up, but I was easily led astray by a good takeaway menu or whatever.
Oh man.
luckily I was 18 and nothing stuck to me. I was a skinny little thing, but now if I had it, I'd be a bit just aware.
Right, I think we're maybe having one or two signal issues there. I never quite caught the end of that. I don't know about you guys. We'll crack on anyway. So, Ben, you know, we've talked about obviously looking after yourself, you know, when you move away from home and everything else. So, how hard was it to leave Cardiff initially? You know, making that decision to move away, was it an easy decision or was it something you really had to take some time to think about?
The last year in Cardiff was quite a difficult one. On the ice, really. Obviously, everywhere it's well documented what was kind of going on to a certain degree. We finished ninth, I believe. A lot going on. But I actually, through that year, I was living away. So I kind of had my own space and I was learning to like live away from the parents kind of thing. So that was kind of a good stepping stone. And obviously then moving away to Glasgow, I think I was already used to living on my own a little bit. So that made it a little bit easier. But it just obviously came about in the summer and it was an opportunity that I was excited to take. Obviously knowing Finna from the time up in Cardiff anyway. And Joe Myers ended up coming with me the first year. So we both ended up moving up and living together. So that was quite good fun.
And you really connected with your line mates as well, didn't you? I mean, the season I'm sort of thinking about in particular is obviously the kind of Champions League season. I remember coming down to training one time and I think you'd formed Yellow Line. It was you and Thomas Nesbitt and it was Ezzy on that as well for Champions League and obviously and Woody as well. So like a combination of you guys. But there was a real chemistry that year. And when the chips were kind of down, it was Yellow Line that kept putting up the points. It wasn't out there to bash bodies and save some energy. It was about getting points on the board.
Yeah, I don't know what Matty thinks about that, but I just think we were all pretty easy going. Mm. Well, I think so. And then we all got on really well. Like Nezzy was really easy going, and me and Matt don't really play like, I don't know. We played with a bit of freedom, and I think we were just able to just go out with, like you say, no pressure to score every night and just work hard. And I think that was kind of in the DNA of the three of our games. So, I really enjoyed it.
Was communication not an issue? Because I remember hearing, you almost tripped up on it then when you were speaking, Nezzy and Ezzy. I was hearing that they were like, Nezzy, you're out there. Nezzy, you're at Ned's, right, that's it. I heard that was an issue.
Yeah, there's It was, but
there's a few too many men calls for that, I think.
Nicknames are important, man. Nicknames are obviously a real key thing. You've got to get what ended up happening in the end. Who took the drop on the nickname?
Neither, I don't think.
I know.
I never got sorted. Because you had to do it, Woody, when obviously Jordan Haywood came. I believe you guys had to kind of have a quick chat. Are you Woody or am I Woody? What's, and he opted for Hazy.
Yeah, it kind of worked out. He was already Hazy and I was
I can imagine that'd be quite tense.
People, North Americans give you nicknames that are just not the best nicknames anyway, so usually the British nicknames stick.
What have you had?
But going back to that line, I think I would say didn't really know what we were doing. Someone else knew what we were doing. So I think as long as we worked hard and we just caused a bit of chaos, I think we were okay.
Even looking back now, though, I think it was probably like it was definitely one of my favorite lines to be a part of. I always just, we just enjoy coming to the ring and playing together. I think we stayed together pretty much all year. And it was
until Nezzy took a slap shot right off my face.
Ezzy or Nezzy?
It's happening Nezzy. Again.
Fusion still reigns.
I remember driving the net and then looking around the D-man and just seeing a puck.
I do remember that.
Is that the worst? Is that the worst you've ever had, Woody? Oh well, of course you've had your shoulders and you've had everything. You've been dismantled and put back together again.
Recovery wise, I would say yeah, because I was eating like blended up chicken and I was eating for a teaspoon. Yeah. Good job, I got a gap in my teeth because I could fit a little teaspoon in there.
You had that thing on him for a while, didn't you?
No, I didn't have a thing. I got plates in my jaw.
Oh, wow.
So I don't have to actually, I didn't have to have a big frame or anything, like, thank God. But yeah, I can still feel the screws now.
I think, Benny, was that the same season as well? I think you got a hit on the, I mean, I'd call it the knee, but you end up developing a second knee cap.
Oh, yeah.
That was a huge, I didn't even really know what, I didn't know what I was looking at, to be honest with you. You went, yeah, have a look at that. And I was like, what is it? Why have you got three kneecaps?
That was, I blocked a shot, must have been accidental, and it was on David Clark, I think, and I played the rest of the game, and I was in agony, it was killing me, and I look back at pictures now, and it's great, like I went to the hospital that night, and I remember we played in Edinburgh the next day, and I had to get like an extra padding put onto the side of the knee, like knee pad. And I played, but it was rough. And it was like a big, it was like a golf ball at the side of my knee. Yeah. Luckily, there was nothing like serious with it. And the bruise the next week was legitimately halfway up my quad and all the way down to my ankle.
That was the most serious looking, non-serious injury I think I've ever seen. Yeah. And I don't even have a quad, I don't think. So it was pretty intense.
Looking back, like I've seen pictures of that. Yes. It's crazy looking, but to say that wasn't a serious injury is lucky.
Yeah. Oh man, crazy.
Kevin, we've not heard from you in a while. Ben played in that team 2014 to 2016. You know, as someone who sees them sort of close up from where you were, he was always a popular guy, wasn't he? He was always someone that the fans really enjoyed. I loved hearing the why, was it Tom Jones one? Geez, I forgot about that. Tom Jones. Man. Yeah, the Delilah.
Delilah.
Oh, yeah. Complete brain fart. I mean, that was always fun.
Yeah, I mean, I always had the impression of Ben as being, you know, for a young guy when he came to us, and you know, he had a lot of experience coming up through Cardiff. But as he said, it was his kind of first time away, so you could hardly say he was an experienced pro. But he gave the impression of being a kind of mature head on young shoulders. You know, you kind of got the impression with Ben that he had an extremely professional attitude off the ice and on the ice. But I think he also brought, you know, as a British player coming into our team, he brought, you know, a relatively high skill level for a Brit and a tremendous heart. So you had that blend of skills and attitude that really just endeared him to the fans and made him a great favourite right from day one, really. And you know, I know a huge, huge part of the fan base were pretty gutted when Ben ended up no longer at the Clan. He was such a popular player there.
Yeah, but that brings me nicely onto a question we've got. Andy 1723 on Twitter. We're taking questions from robots now. He says, "I genuinely feel that Ben was one of our best ever British players and could have been an asset since." Have I written that? Could have been an asset since. Well, has there ever been a chance of a return to the Clan? And if so, what stopped that from happening?
Yeah. So, like, like Kevin just touched on there, like I loved it. Like that, I think the songs and stuff came in on the second year for everyone, and I did really enjoy the song that I had, and obviously everyone up in the blocks. It was a brilliant atmosphere, so I want to touch on that. And still got some really close friends up there, then I try to see as much as possible when we're back up and playing. But the next year, obviously, I moved and went and tried over in Norfolk. And I was speaking to Finner, obviously, when I did decide I was coming back. But obviously, didn't pan out, and talked to those guys through the summer before going over. But since then, not really too much, because I've been further down south, and I've kind of been in Guildford since that year. So, So since that first year away, not as much. But I did definitely look at coming back the next year, because I love my 2 years up there.
It's a really different setup in Guildford, isn't it, Ben? I mean, you've played for these the British teams you've played for have all been really, really different in terms of their setup. One thing I really really liked about Guildford when I came down and caught up with you briefly as well, and what a lovely wee town it is as well when you go around Guildford, a really beautiful, quaint wee city. And it just seems crazy as well when we're talking to some of the people that work there, it doesn't seem to matter what night they play on, obviously, for the clan. Like, we seem so dependent on getting our big Friday nights, Saturday nights. People want that big night from us. Midweeks are difficult for people, a lot of families and stuff. You know, every team's different. But Guildford, it's the same numbers come every night, don't they? It could be a Tuesday, could be a Saturday, whatever. It just seems to work. That's the big news in the town is the Guildford Flames.
It really is. And I don't know why that is exactly, but I think they do have their season tickets potentially that come every game. And there's not an awful lot of fluctuations from that. So it is more or less, I would say, about the 1,700, 2,000 attendance-wise that they get week in, week out. And it doesn't obviously go further up than that, but it doesn't ever go further down, regardless of what night it is. So, yeah, they kind of got their fan base, and everyone's really loyal and comes every week. And
you have the Army of One, that guy that sings the two Guildford.
Yeah.
That is some effort. I mean, he doesn't stop, does he?
Every game.
Let's go Guildford. And then Guildford, cha-cha-cha. I think that's the other on cycle. And you know what? Eventually, I think that does get in the head, doesn't it? I think you're like going, oh, my God.
Yeah, those guys, honestly, they show commitment for the team. They're every game, home or away, Dundee on a Sunday night. Those guys are there. And, they're part of the team in a way, really, in that respect. So, yeah, they show big commitment, and he doesn't stop. Yeah, that's for sure.
Speaking of Guildford, you were joined by a famous footballer last year, Petr Cech, the former Chelsea. Well, he's still a Chelsea goalie, I suppose. Did you get a chance to meet him and sort of work with him? What was it like? And you can tell Matt what he was like. Matt being a big Chelsea fan, of course.
Is he a Chelsea fan? Doncaster Rovers, isn't it?
Yeah. I like a few.
Doncaster Rovers and the Welsh team.
Yeah, what they call TNS.
TNS.
Total Network Solutions.
Oh, they're a powerhouse in the Welsh Premier League.
And they haven't lost the league in about 5 years, 6 years, have they?
I know. They're like the Welsh Bayern Munich. But for the 3 years I was at Guildford, he came to practice. So the first year he was there as much as he could. I believe he was still up. Yeah, he was playing at Arsenal a lot that year, because Arsene Wenger was still there.
Yeah.
And then the following year, they had that new coach or manager that came in, and his schedule was a lot different. So he didn't come to practice an awful lot that year. The second one, but then last year again, he was at practice as much as he could. He loves it, and he's a good goalie. He just every time he can come down, he just rocks down. He leaves his kit obviously at the rink, and often he'll come down. The last year, because he's in Chelsea, and it's only maybe 20-30 minutes from the training facility of Chelsea.
Wow.
He just fly over. Sometimes I think he'd just be like at a meeting. and come pop on the ice with us for an hour and then shoot back off. And he'd come fully kitted in his Chelsea stuff sometimes. And obviously, if a call comes in, he's got to take it. But yeah, honestly, couldn't say enough good things about him. He's you can see he's a top professional, and you can see why he's been at the top of his game for so long. He's just, you come in and just speak to anybody, whoever's around there, you give anyone a time of day. And he was brilliant with all the boys. And yeah, you just, the one time we had an injury, Brian Stewart got injured 1 week, and he was legitimately our backup. He was like, I'm sure they would have, if he could have, with his commitments, he would have come away with us. Because the whole week he was coming at every practice, and like he'd be taking headshots and everything. Like it didn't bat an eyelid to him. But yeah, obviously he had to go back to his real life then after that. But
what's the story though, Benny? Did you get the, I mean, what was the idea that he used being a hockey goalie as a way of like honing his skills for the season coming, or was it just, you reckon, just because he really loved the hockey? Because can you imagine if he took an injury, if he got one in the throat, or like if you got an hit or a hand injury, like something, you'd be like,
and, I don't know.
You know, that's a high chance.
I think he did have something like that worked into his contract towards the end of his career. But I think earlier on, I think he was still practicing with Guildford. Obviously, I wasn't there at this time. But I think potentially, I don't know what was happening. But yeah, he was probably on the side of caution injury-wise. But I do think it was a bit of both. I think he just loved being out and playing hockey because he played when he was younger. And obviously ended up playing football. But I think it probably did that, how he is and wanted to be great at everything. I think he's just, he used it as being a better football goalie as well. I think he did probably help with his reaction times and stuff like that. But
yeah,
you'd have to ask him, I think. But yeah, definitely.
He's, it'd just like, be hilarious if someone took a penalty and he just came right out to him. Just a little, as you say, trigger brain fart.
He did play like two touch with us a few times, and we were out one time playing headers and volleys out on the athletics track at the back, and he came out with us. And yeah, it's just cool being able to see you played a little bit with Peter Cech. He didn't go in goal or anything, but
just
kicking a ball around, like he was wicked fun.
Now, you're one of the few players who's actually played hockey in the UK this year since the coronavirus pandemic. You were part of the Swindon team that took part in the streaming series quite recently. I'm keen to find out a bit more about that. Obviously, we know how the games went and everything else. What was it like playing in front of an empty rink? That would have been weird. And tell us a bit more about the protocols they had, the COVID stuff, you know, to protect you guys.
Yeah, so every time for practice or a game, you had to fill like a questionnaire in on the phone, do a temperature check. And then everyone was like socially distanced, whether we're in a changing room or wherever we were, they were spread out between changing rooms. Barely even saw the other team go into any of the games, really. I don't really think there was any contact other than obviously being on the ice. So yeah, it was a lot different in that respect, but very well organized, everything. The one thing with, I was going to say with Matty as well, Matty would know, but playing in front of like no fans, we've both done it playing with GB when we were like under 20s and stuff like that. You're not playing in front of any fans then. So we've kind of both been in that situation, and it was very similar to that. Obviously it just is the way it is right now, and that's what it's going to have to be, or little fans. But I'm sure everyone would rather there be hockey and be able to watch at home rather than there not be hockey. But hopefully everyone can be back in arenas soon. You see it in football stadiums right now, and the atmosphere is a massive part of all sport, right? So that's, fingers crossed.
Yeah. Yeah, it would have been nice just to be playing again, I'm sure. So what happens from now on? Obviously, the NIHL were using those series of games as a test event, really, to see if we get hockey after the new year. Have you heard any more about what's likely to happen after we get to 2021?
No, I haven't right now. I believe they were using it somewhat as a test and to see if they could run it, really. Like, it did seem to go off smoothly the two weekends I was involved. Since I played, I think that the announcement through the government for the funding has kind of opened up maybe other avenues that leagues are potentially looking at. So I'm I'm not sure where things are there, but the sooner we get hockey back in this country, the better, because it seems like most other countries around Europe, for good or bad, are playing. So, yeah, hopefully we can get some back in Britain, because there's an awful lot of British hockey players, mine and Matty's age, younger, older, that want to be playing right now. And I think especially for like some of the younger kids, they're not being able to, one, get on the ice and practice, and two, play games. So the sooner, hopefully, things get resolved from grassroots up, the better, really.
Yeah, that's something I've been thinking about recently as well, is all like every year you have people that get won over by the sport as well. Every year you get people that get their first taste of hockey and get, you know, talking about bugs, but get the hockey bug, you know, and you're thinking about all those young kids, and it's, you know, in the UK, it's very different ages. It's not like everyone comes in at 3 and 4 and starts learning hockey. People are like 7, 8, 9, 10, all these. And, you know, we've maybe got like a wee lost generation there, you know, like people have kind of slipped away. So you're right, it needs to... Yeah, hopefully it isn't going to be too long. It looks like the Elite League was always talking about August anyway, but obviously there's this kind of situation going on. We'll see what happens. It looks like it might just be the English teams as well at the moment. So we'll see how the devolved governments feel about that one. So it'll be interesting to see where it goes. But like, it looks like we've got a light at the end of the tunnel. It's sad to think of people not getting in, all those missed people. Just feels like a real shame.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, yeah, like you say, there's new fans coming into the sport every year. So yeah. If there's a way that... Obviously, British ice hockey can bring those in, whether that be through streaming, YouTube clips, promotion through Sky Sports, whatever. I don't know, but yeah, it does seem like a shame that, like you say, you're losing out on those new fans.
And the prep for GB. I mean, you guys would be both aiming for slots in those teams as well, and like that's a major concern, isn't it? Have you spoke to your GB teammates and stuff, and you know, is there a lot of concern there? Are people doing whatever they can? Obviously, there's a tournament coming up, and GB's had such a boost recently.
Yeah, I know. As far as I know, things are still on the way to play the World Championships next year. I think quite a few of the boys are lucky enough. They outplaying hockey to some degree, but obviously there's still quite a few that are not. So. Yeah, it's a difficult one right now, but fingers crossed, early next year, everyone's playing and there can be a camp for selection and everyone gets a go at being on that plane ride over to the World Championships, and GB can put in a really good performance again next year.
You're going to have to do something special to outdo what happened last time, and you're going to have to do something special to outdo your goals as well. But, you know, what was your favourite? For me, I thought the USA goal, I was like, I was absolutely so chuffy, and I can imagine like just how buzzed your family were as well, but to see you scoring against the US national team. And I know that's not even the goal people talk about, but I just, it was fantastic snipe, and I just thought what a thrill that tournament was. And but that was a real highlight for me. What was that like?
Yeah it was unbelievable. Like it was just such an experience to just, one, be playing in those games, and then two, get like the opportunity to get some good chances. And yeah, like I obviously was lucky enough to score a few goals, and I've got the stick, so I've still got it. I want to try and get them put in like frames or something like that, because that's not something that happens all the time, is it? So it's something I want to look back on at some point. And yeah, to score against USA was special. Like, obviously, some of those guys we were playing against, like, our rosters didn't really match up. But, yeah, that was probably my most enjoyable game. I think that the France one was quite stressful. But the USA one was, we could just kind of go out and enjoy it. And I think you speak to everyone on that team.
Well, it was only stressful because you did a drop pass on a breakaway.
Yeah, I forgot about that.
AR Woody swipes in. Oh, dear. Woody, what happens on these podcasts is we get them on and we just tell them how much we love them. You've not got the hang of this, have you? You're just coming on chirping the guy.
I'm in an
you
out.
You don't need to do it.
I'm in an out, and I'm hearing Kevin telling how great he is, and I don't like that. I need everybody to know that he's actually not that good of a guy. Just because he's Welsh and he seems friendly, he's not actually that friendly.
He's not even Welsh.
I want to ask you all while you're all here, and Ben and I did a piece about that goal in the World Championships earlier in the summer, and I want to know where you all were, and you know, when Ben scored that goal against France to keep GB up. Start with you, Gerry. Where were you when Ben got that big goal, and how did you celebrate?
Well, my one's going to be a very hilarious one for you, is because myself and Gareth had a meeting down with Neil. And I couldn't believe he called it during that game. So we were down in London, and we'd gone for this place to meet Neil. And I was like, the game's on? I can't believe we're meeting here. Neil might not be happy with this, but I'll be honest with you. He's like, well, they're not going to win, are they? And I was like, you never know. Like, you never know. Like, and then it was like, we were checking. It's like, was it 3-0 down, 2-0 down?
Yeah.
And then I was like, hey, they're coming back. And then I was like, right, we need to scramble and see it. So we managed to catch up with it at the end, like, get this wrapped up. So it was like super exciting way to kind of catch up with it, because you know the expectation was that France were going to win that game. But you know anyone that's been watching GB over the last few years and under Pete know that they love to do things dramatically right at the end, and I think that kind of spirit is amazing. And the way Pete rolls out the lines, everyone's getting so much ice time, so it's spread, so you know that GB team can keep going till the end. So it was a pretty cool way to see it, because I'd said I thought they could do it, and I felt like that was all about me. Yeah. So thanks, Benny. Thanks for proving me right. I appreciate it. It was for
Kevin.
Me.
Well, I was nothing as exciting as Gerry, but I was sitting on my own in my living room. But you know, Ben, you touched on it a wee while ago about sometimes international hockey, there's no real atmosphere, and you know, sometimes it's quite kind of sterile a little bit. I personally find it quite difficult to get excited sometimes watching international hockey. But that game, and in particular that moment, I was like bouncing off the ceiling. You know, very rarely do I get excited about hockey.
You're our announcer at the arena.
I usually keep quite a level head about it all, and try and take it all in. But that, you know, that was one of the few times when I've got really excited about a moment in a game, and particularly because it was, you know, somebody that I knew, Benny, that was scoring the goal, and you know, it was just a fantastic moment. And I remember, Ben, when you were with us up in Bray Head, there was one of the seasons you were with us. Everybody expected you to get picked for GB. And I remember one of the selections, Matty got picked and Benny didn't. And I remember talking to Matt the night the squad
was... What are you trying to say?
Yeah, Woody's like, where are you going with that? No.
We were really expecting Ben would be in as well. And I remember talking to you, Woody, and you were actually, although you were in, you sounded absolutely gutted because Benny hadn't got in. And I've always remembered that. And for Benny to be such a key member of that squad and to score that fantastic goal, I thought it was just amazing and absolutely fantastic moment.
Right, we've heard Kevin's version, we've heard Gerry's version of events that day Ben scored his goal. What were you up to that day, Matt?
Well, as every other GB fan, I was sat watching the game, but when they went 3-0 down, I had to go to the shops. I thought, there's no chance of coming back with this. See, and then I obviously had flash scores on, and 3-1, 3-2, and then 3-3, and so it went to overtime. And I kind of turned to Jenny when I was there, and I was like, it'd be nice if Benny gets this, because he's had a good tournament. And then I was like, but it's overtime, so Benny's not going to get any eggs. And obviously, he scored, and then it comes up, obviously, the next time. So it was Benny, so I was over the moon for him, because, you know, like, we just touched upon there that we've never actually played GB together. We've kind of always taken each other's spot, but obviously, he was in the team before me, and then I went in, so he had that lull out of the team, so it just showed his character, how it's driven him on to be not just get back in the team, but just to be one of the main guys in that squad now. Even with all the dual nationals and that, I think Benny's one of the better players in that team. So it's a credit to his personality and the type of person, like his grit and his Welsh nature, I'd say. But that's the only nice thing I'm going to say about him for the rest of the podcast.
Well, the day Benny scored that goal, I think I've told you this already, Ben. I was at work that day, so I had it on in work, and as kind of touched upon, GB went 3-0 down. So you're thinking, oh, this isn't going so well. So knocking off time, I'm heading home on a bus in Ayrshire. Me and about half a dozen people on this bus, and you're willing the team on. You know, I'm sitting and listening on the radio. I've got Seth Bennett in my ear, telling us what's happening. And I'm willing
nobody
the team
wants,
on.
Nobody wants that.
Next thing you know, Benny scored. I have leapt out of my seat on the bus to shout and whatever else. And I think I basically scared the crap out of all the passengers on the bus, completely unaware of what I was listening to and why I would react in such a way. So there you go, Benny. That was the effect you had on us all that day.
What bus was this, Craig?
What's that?
What bus was it? I'm just trying to figure out if it's one of those places where people probably shout on the bus all the time that you were going to. That's normal.
A service bus taking me from one part of Ayrshire to the little village I live in Ayrshire. So it was a surprise. Yeah, so there we go. So there you go, funny thing
with those that France game, though, like my sister and my partner Al, they came out a few games previous, watched a few games, they shot off, obviously went back for work and that. And then my mum, dad and my little sister came out for two games. And they actually flew back the day of the France game because my little sister had her final GCSEs.
Oh.
So they hadn't watched, they obviously didn't watch that France game live. They flew back into Heathrow or wherever it was.
No way.
Started back down the M4 and they watched the game late. So they recorded it, turned all their phones off or whatever. And they watched it maybe it was like 2 hours later. Well, I'm obviously off the game then, like calming down a bit, just wanting to give him a bell and talk to him kind of thing. And I had to wait like 2-3 hours before I could like get on the phone. Obviously, as soon as they called then, I they're screaming down the phone. And it was like 2 hours previous or whatever. But that's a kind of a cool story. But yeah, they obviously weren't there for the game. So yeah, it was pretty funny.
What did the players do after that game, Benny? Was there some good celebrations back at the old hotel? Was there anywhere to go? Or
Yeah, we kind of went into town. Obviously, went back to the hotel, calmed down, or got food, and then headed out. But we hung around the rink for a little while, I think, after. Yeah, it's all a bit of a blur, to be honest. And then we ended up...
that good a night, was it?
In a bar. And it was actually the same place the French team were.
So,
yeah, that obviously the game was on highlights at one point there as well. So, yeah, it was kind of a rough
awkward.
Then, but then they shot off and we ended up having a good
My night favorite there. Thing about those celebrations, Benny, and I didn't realize it, and I spoke to Bouncy, and he said, if you watch the game back, watch Benny's celebration and just keep your eyes on Benny when everybody else comes in. And I don't know if anyone's seen it. So he has an initial celebration with someone. So I think it must be John, I can see.
Yeah, John.
So they both hug, and then John just turns around and hugs, and everyone goes to John. And Benny's just stood there with no gloves on, jumping up and down. I watch it back. It's the funniest thing ever. Just watch Benny. It's so funny.
Honestly, it was great. Blacked out. It was just great.
Right, you won't know what you're doing. You're so
Just. It was insane. Obviously, you see that the cut from the bench and everyone's jumping over. Davey falls over. Bouncy's running down the ice.
Fastest Bouncy's moved in 25 years.
Yeah, I know. Some of us got our helmets off. Some got them on and just celebrating. We just obviously stayed.
You've got your mouth guard up there on your face.
Yeah, I know. It was crazy. But yeah, seeing the celebrations is wicked fun.
It's some achievement. Is it? And the focus, obviously, is trying to achieve that again. And the way the World Championships were setting up, it was going to be an even tougher challenge because obviously GB would have had to finished two places. Oh, you'd have to have defeated two teams, really, wouldn't you? Because of where it's been hosted the following year.
Yeah.
So Belarus would have
points in two games. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Which is obviously just points are hard to come by. But I mean, look, you've got everyone believing that everything's possible, and obviously the team believe in that as well. So it's going to be, let's hope, fingers crossed, everything goes ahead. More good memories.
Definitely.
Yeah. They probably got a stronger team. Sorry, Craig. They probably got a stronger team because they've got, I know, like Travis eligible. He was going to play, and I think Cons is going to be there as well this year as well. So
yeah,
I think they're a stronger team. So they definitely got a chance.
Now, we've covered it in quite a bit of depth here, Ben, and you and I did something earlier in the summer, as I've said, and I've seen you pop up on other podcasts and done various articles. Do you ever get sick talking about it?
No, it's such like a cool experience and just like something that, no, not really, but it just, the whole experience was just insane. And then for it to just be capped off with like us staying up in like dramatic fashion, like you say, and having a good tournament and being able to score a goal out there and everything like that. And no, it was wicked. It was really, really.
Do you know what I would compare it to? I would compare it to the David Beckham free kick against Greece.
No, never heard of that. Jerry, do you know that one? I've never heard of that
one. I think you've picked the wrong audience for this one, would you? I like your bold effort
I would pick
three Scotsmen and a Welshman and a clan fan base listening in there. Go and tell us
about Robson England. Canoes took a turn against Belgium, don't you?
I was going to say that, and then I was going to say James McFadden's goal against France from 45 yards out.
Oh, yeah.
How about David Marshall saving the penalty against
on the same
Serbia.
Wavelength now, man.
Maradona's handball, was it a bit like that? Was it like Maradona's? It was like soon. That was a big moment.
Too soon.
I'm honouring the memory. I'm honouring
it. This brings me nicely to a question from Megan Reed. She's a huge fan of yours, Ben, and she's asking, it's already been asked, out with that goal for GB, which we've obviously talked about, what would you say was your best memory from your hockey career? What's your best memory from your career? I thought she meant the clan, but no, the career. Go for it.
I don't know. The one that sticks to mind, that Matty was in the team, and it's a weird one in a way, but it's one I'll probably always remember, like looking back over things. And it was when we were in Hungary. For the 20s tournament, and we were in the Brecken, so it was like a nice arena. We were playing against Hungary for the gold medal the last game, and they were a very good team. They were maybe a bit better than us, and we had
way better than us.
And how good was our team, Matt?
Yeah, well, I think they had a few NHL guys. They turned out to be NHL players.
Did they?
Something like that. I might be making that up, but maybe it sound better for the story.
Yeah, we had eight NHL players. Anyway, we end up, long story short, we end up drawing that game and going to overtime. But I scored a goal in that game where Matty Davis shot the puck and it hit the goalie, saved it, hit the plexi at the back. And I drove the net, and the puck landed on top of the net.
Right.
And I drove the net, and no one really knew where it was. And it's on video, like it's a YouTube clip in Hungary.
I was on the ice with you there, Betty. I remember this.
And I flicked the puck. I don't think anyone else did. And really quickly, I hit the top of the net with my stick, caught it, and as I'm getting like whacked and like pushed over, I threw the puck in the net. I don't know if this should go. I don't know if this should go stream now. I'm getting caught red handed.
Well, that is like a Maradona.
I illegally scored a goal.
Yeah.
And they allowed it. And then the next pace off play, I took a puck in that, like a stick in the face. Like they obviously knew what happened. They allowed it. We drew 4-4. We went to shootout. Ended up winning.
We've seen the dark side of Benny now.
Pardon?
You're right, Woody. This is the dark side of Benny coming out. Getting to the end of the podcast. Dirty tricks. Flat, throwing pucks.
But we ended up getting promoted.
Nice guy. Get out.
It meant like our top age, we could go and play some really good nations and really test ourselves with the likes of like Bouncy. We had Bachi. We had Jack Prince, Sam Smith, Joey Lewis. We had a ton of players then for the next year. And Farmer, the list goes on and on. But that was one that really sticks to mind that I think was a memory that obviously wasn't the best part of my game, but it was something
I was behind the net on that, Benny, when you did that. And I just remember your face.
Sorry guys, I've got double IHF on the phone, Ben. They're wanting to work.
I remember
looking at each other, like, as you threw it in, and we were like, and nobody said anything. Fans were going, man, this is the first time we've played in front of more than 1,000
fans. Yeah, it
was
like 5,000 people in there.
It was so many, and it was live on TV, like, national the Hungary TV. It was mental. And he's,
wow.
And he's obviously throwing it in, and he's got, we're kind of looking at each other. You know, it feels like forever, but it's probably like a second, and we're like, What do we do?
Yeah. Yeah, we've just started celebrating hard off like, the bench.
Refs like,
that's just the actual chain, guys. Like, the story you're telling is a story
actually,
of
I'll give Benny credit.
Corruption.
I think, he didn't throw it in. Like, he's making this sound worse. Oh, he's backpedaling. And he got hit, and he's let the puck go. But he shouldn't have grabbed the puck. Should have been a goal, but he didn't throw it in.
He just kind of accidentally got his stick underneath the net, flicked it up, and accidentally caught it.
But you're allowed to do that.
Yeah, but he accidentally caught it and threw it in the net.
Yeah. If there's
an accident, he caught it and he got
not allowed to do that.
No, it's fine.
Everyone's doing all
it. That game, we ended up scoring another goal. There was a way high stick. Tom Duggan scored a goal, and he literally was like this.
But anyway, we had three shots, and we won 4-3 on penalty shots.
Which, disgrace.
A good classy GB performance.
I love it. Who was the coach then at this time?
Pete Russell.
It was Pete. Yeah, what was Pete saying? Like, fine, mate, just carry on, just keep going.
Crack on.
Listen, boys, carry on. Do you understand, boys? Carry on. Listen, do you understand? Let's just carry on. Honestly, does that make sense? Just do it again. Does that make sense?
It's crazy, but there's highlights somewhere though, that game. You have to get down to YouTube, but like some of the goals, like I remember looking, Kieran Long scores like an unbelievable penalty shot at the end as well.
To win it.
Yeah.
Brilliant. So we need to see this game, man. This is a different one we need to hunt down. This sounds fantastic.
Oh, you look through the team sheet of it as well. Like we had a very strong team, and it was that was one of my memories. I think that was the first year we were Bouncy and Murdy invented a game that we played off the ice, which stuck around for a while as well.
That sounds very, very cloak and dagger.
We were playing cricket out off ice, which was pretty good fun as well.
Off ice cricket. Do you know, it's mad, you know, you're saying that Pete Russell was the head coach then, and like when you actually think it, like what Pete's been through with the GB setup and with you guys as well, like it's so lovely that he was the head coach for GB when they've stayed up as well, and he's just consistently been there as the GB setup's been more and more successful. Do you think how much of that is down to Pete and his kind of personality style and determination, the way he is prepped, and how much of it is the right players at the right time? What's the balance there, do you think? It's a loaded question, isn't it? It's difficult to...
Anyone? Obviously, Pete's been around and coached us while we were juniors and come through, so he knows a massive proportion of the senior team now from when they were younger, so he knows how everyone plays pretty much inside and out.
Yeah,
and I'm sure obviously he's in Germany now, but I'm sure he's keeping track of like younger ones coming through. He's speaking to some of the national team coaches of the younger age groups and going through there. And I think Pete's always been very X's and O's, and he's very good at his system wise. So that's one thing you always see in his teams, and we've always been well structured coming through the national ranks. So I think that's always helped us, and we've always obviously had a good team because it's a national team, so we're already loaded there usually. Mm. But I think like we've both, me and Matt, grown up playing under Pete as under 18s, under 20s, and so on. So.
Right. I think there won't be many coaches that have that.
No, I think he makes GB a surprise package every year, at whatever age group, and I mean that in a nice way, because people write GB off all like tournaments we've been in. We've been like 4th, 5th seed, and we've won it, sort of thing. And like teams just don't even like consider you an option, and you end up being the best team there because of how well drilled. Even though we've had the 2-week camp or whatever.
Yeah.
He's just got this knack of getting guys just to rally, and he's that's just a proud guy, and he rubs off on you. You know? I mean,
that's the thing that strikes me, Woody, is like when it comes to either the GB setup or the clan team that we saw under Pete, from the get-go, everyone looks like they know what the game plan is right now. Every single player looks like there's no kind of like sounding a game out or anything like that. People just engage straight away. And like, you definitely see that with Team GB. And I know you're saying like in overtime, certain lines obviously going to get a bit more time. But generally speaking, he seems to have a lot of faith in every player that he's got there. And it seems to be spread out. And for me, that looks like it makes a difference, because you're talking about games in junior level where that same story's happening again. Like, it's at the end of the game that GB's coming through. And I think that really comes from personality, grit, and organisation. I was just wondering if that's something that you guys had felt yourselves from being in it. Does it feel like that when you're working?
I think it's more natural. I think it's more natural when we play with the national team, though. I think when he was with us, with the Clan, I think he was... It took about 3-4 weeks for it all to kind of get going. Mm. I think that it took, especially the North American guys and the European guys, a little while just to get used to what he was trying to get across and why he was doing it, blah, blah, blah. But once everyone kind of gets the message and stuff and sees the British guys doing it, I think once everyone starts pushing in the right direction, it's definitely the best system coach I've ever had.
Yeah. And it's great to see guys. I mean, obviously Pete's done really well with Freiburg and is having another blinder at the moment. But Benny as well, obviously there's like quite a few British guys making their way over into the European leagues now as well. At the moment, you mentioned Farmer before, is obviously in Del 2 as well, isn't he? And there's guys doing well. And this lockout, as it were, you know, this lockdown, as it were, at least that's kind of leading to, I think that kind of experience is an opportunity for people as well, isn't it? We're going to see guys getting a bit of, you know, a different style and a different opportunity. There could be hopefully some positives. Do you think that's possible to come from this?
I think absolutely. I think moving forward, I think potentially it could be a good thing for British hockey that players have had to look abroad for jobs in this time, because obviously the Elite League or the EPL, these leagues are not going ahead right now. So whether they're a younger player looking to get over to some of the leagues, or like an established player like Richardson or Farmer, like you say, hopefully you think some of these players can stay out, and it can be a norm for British players to move abroad and start to change the reputation that, like when me and Haywood were younger, it'd be very difficult for us to have gone abroad, because you're coming from Great Britain and there's maybe not the respect of the league or the national team or anything potentially back then. But now I think it's starting to change. And if that means in the years to come, some younger players can get opportunities to move to Germany, Sweden, I don't know, Denmark, some of these leagues, and start to play out there and do similar to what Joey Lewis has done. And he's made a living out there, and he's well established in his league, which is a very good league. So I see in that, hopefully in 5-10 years time, there's an awful lot more British players from the national team that are playing overseas, and this can hopefully start to move the British game on, because you see with other national teams that they're not all just playing in one league. Whereas like I'm sure you guys have seen it with the British team, that pretty much the majority of the players, for whatever reason, are all playing in the national team.
Yeah.
So, I don't know. It's just one aspect I was thinking. I think it could be a good step in the right direction, in a good direction for GB players.
Yeah, so you look at that Denmark team that you played against in the World Championships. You know, like, most of those guys weren't playing in Denmark. I mean, there was a good, healthy amount of them. And similarly, I think that's why that French result was so good, because there's some good hockey in the French leagues as well, but a lot of those guys were playing in different leagues as well, and there was some real caliber there. So, and I just think I think you've all done such a fantastic job in terms of the players in their elite league and our international representatives for really establishing a great reputation for the country as well, and that goes for the coaches as well, Pete and even Corey Nielsen, guys that have been in our leagues and going away and doing great jobs over there. Like, it's good to see that the reputation is, people will be keeping an eye on GB now, and I don't think GB will be treated quite so lightly in the next tournament. So that'll be bring a challenge in itself, especially Belarus will have a point to prove as well, because obviously there's a lot of politics and stuff going on in hockey at the moment. But I think it's really exciting. It's hopefully we get through this crazy time and there's a lot of good times to come.
Yeah, right,
fingers crossed. Before we start to wrap up, I've got one more question from a fan, which I'll get to. And have you guys got anything else you want to ask Ben while we're all here?
No, are you worried I'm going to ask a big question?
I want to ask Matt what he's drinking there. Is it Tetley?
Get him off the podcast.
Is it Yorkshire tea in a Tim Hortons mug?
It is.
That just says everything about your personality. Yorkshire tea in a Tim Horton mug.
Yeah. Matt Haywood in a
t-shirt.
Right, let's get to this last question then. And I love these questions because there's a story behind it and I want to find out what it is. Mr. Zach Sullivan is asking you, Ben, are the boyos still boycotting the Fantasy Football League? Over to you.
So there's a football, not American football, like soccer. Football.
Yeah, not throwing not football, football.
Yeah, we get it.
Real football. Team Sully and Matt and all are put together, and they wanted some overseas competition this year. So I've been brought into
for Wales.
So I tried to put an all Welsh team together, but that failed pretty quickly. But yeah, I don't know. It's a bit of a farce from Sully there. I think it's not run particularly well, but I don't know. We're trying to make the best of it, really.
Sully's tried to set up this league for the last 4 or 5 seasons, and he's not been able to do it once. This is the first year he's actually gone through and made a league happen.
That explains a few things.
Pretty, it's not the best. I've got to give him that. But he's trying. Benny is actually currently last in this league.
No.
I can show you right now, he is. The boyos.
It's hard to argue
with that. Bad bounces. I didn't actually think I was last. I thought I was like joint last.
Yeah, you're last.
Good stuff. We'll start wrapping it there, guys. Thank you so much. This has been a lot of fun. I've thoroughly enjoyed this. A few things to take you through before we end. Clan Classics game this Saturday is the Clan versus Coventry Blaze from the 2nd of December 2017, featuring those excellent handprint jerseys. You can see that at 7 o'clock on Saturday on the Clan YouTube channel. Shirt off the backs are on sale. As always, find those links on Clan social media. The jerseys up for grabs this week is a purple Kyle Jones jersey, a black Ash Goldie jersey, and a white Tim Wedderburn jersey. You don't want to miss those. The equipment raffle this week, you can win a white Scott Pitt helmet. Check out the Clan social media for links to all of those. And this weekend, we've also got our virtual Air the Bear. It's not throwing your teddy bears at the screen, although you can do that if you want, but I wouldn't recommend it. If you do want to donate, it's all about donations. The Glasgow Children's Hospital Charity and Ronald McDonald House. So you know what to do, Purple Army. Just donate what you would have paid for a soft toy, and remember and quote Clan Air the Bear when you do so. Find the links on the website as well. And we're also building up to our big Christmas 50-50 draw taking place on Boxing Day at 9 p.m. So get involved with that and you could be a lucky winner over the festive period. That's it from this edition of Clan Chat. Quite a lengthy one for you this week, so thank you very much for watching. Guys, thank you very, very much for joining us. Gerry, catch you next week.
Yeah, catch you then.
Magic. Kevin, good to see you again.
And you, good to be back.
And Matt, whatever, do what you like.
Depends who's on.
And Benny, great to have you on board. Good to catch up with you. Hopefully, we'll see you back in action before too long.
Cheers, thanks, Benny. Guys. Appreciate it.
Excellent.
Cheers.
Have a great week. Have a great weekend, everybody. We'll catch you back on Clan Chat next week. Bye for now.